Catholic Answers Live, open forum today. Any question that you've got about the Catholic Church, about Catholic faith, about Catholic people, about what Catholics do, why they do those things, and what the beliefs are behind all that is welcome. Anybody can call on open forum day. If you're Catholic, you can call. If you're not Catholic, you can call. As a matter of fact, I will start right from the beginning today, encouraging non-Catholics to call. If you're an atheist, you're welcome to call. If you're agnostic, you're welcome to call. If you're a fellow Christian of a different ecclesial community, you're welcome to call. Buddhists, Hindus, Shintoists, anybody, you can call 888-318-7884. If you have a question about the Catholic faith, we want to answer it, 888-318-7884. And both hours today, we have our own Director of Apologetics and Evangelization, Tim Staples, here. Hi, Tim. How are you?
Cy Kellett, it is great to be with you.
Tim's book that I always keep on the desk here next to me, Behold Your Mother, A Biblical and Historical Defense of the Marian Doctrines. Certainly that's one area people like to ask questions about, Mary and why Catholics believe what they do and behave the way they do towards Mary. That's welcome as well, 888-318-7884. We just starting last Thursday, going through Sunday morning, we had our great big giant Catholic mm-hmm. Answers Faith and Science Conference. Tim, you gave a talk there on miracles. You also did the show with us Thursday. Thank you for doing that. What did you think of the conference overall?
We rocked the house.
It was
impressive. I honestly, I'm so impressed with Erica and Emily and all the folks behind the scenes, the logistics people.
Right.
I'm always blown away by them because, as I say to you, I've said it to you before, Cy, I can't even keep my desk organized.
Yeah, I know. I
cannot understand how human beings can put together an event like that, but they did. And that was attention to detail. Everything went so smooth. I heard that from our guest speakers as well as the guests. So it went really well. And I'm going to tell you, for those of y'all who didn't make it this year, shame on you, but we're going to give you another chance.
Use that old Catholic guilt on them.
In 1 year, you're going to get another chance. No, we are going to be doing it the next 2 years there at the Hyatt Regency in La Jolla.
Because they just do a fantastic job, too. I mean, they take care of us there.
They do. Faith and Science, too, by the way. Yeah. Great topic. I thought the guys really hit it out of the park, our Catholic Answers guys. I'm just sticking my buttons popping off my vest.
Yeah, you know? They did a really, really good job. Carlos started with a joke and playing accordion.
That's right. That's and, right. Carlos right over here.
Yeah.
There he goes. He's playing his accordion again.
just so much good stuff. You spoke, however, Tim, about miracles. What made you think that you wanted to talk about miracles at a conference on faith and science?
Yes. Well, I thought it was really important because miracles are gifts. As I said in the first opening statement of my talk, these are gifts that God has given to us to convince the skeptic and those that are hurting and not able to believe for whatever reason, but skeptics in particular. And so, of course, for a conference like this, I thought it was a good thing because, you know, we can get so carried away with our intellectual prowess and we're going to give Thomas's five proofs for the existence of God and we're going to show, and all that is, of course, crucial. And we were talking before we went on the air, Thomas's fifth proof, right? That science, really properly understood, points in the direction of God, because basically all we're doing in science is we're showing the fingerprint of God. We're labeling stuff. That's all. We're looking at this incredible creation of God, and we're labeling it. And then we think we're smart. Well, where did it come from, man?
Yeah, yeah.
It came from Almighty God. And the fact that you have all of this these incredible things in science, as Cy and I were talking about, you know, all of these beings and things acting for ends that they themselves did not create, did not devise, just, you know, it's Psalm 19:1, the heavens declare the glory of God.
Amen.
I mean, that's
right.
Science, it just so gloriously shows the handiwork of God. But for those who struggle, we have something even more. God intervenes supernaturally and performs miracles so that, and I loved, as you know, Cy, I quoted session 3 of Vatican Council I, Chapter 3, in its definitions on miracles and two canons there, the Council Fathers say that miracles are the most certain proof of the veracity of revelation and of revelation itself. So my goodness, it was crucial that we get that message in there so that folks know, look, you don't have to have a PhD in physics to tell somebody about the miracle of Lanciano or Padre Pio's incredible miracles that God worked through Padre Pio, or as, you know, two of my favorites. I for those who weren't there, I gave seven of my favorite miracles, among the thousands that we have to choose from. But I love the miracles of Lourdes. Now we have 70. I was actually one off. I said 69. Actually, there's been another one approved just this year.
Wow.
Because I said 69 at the conference, but there's another one that was just approved this year, which is incredible, man. 70 miracles. I referenced two of them from August 20th and August 21st. First of 1896, where two young women, unbeknownst to each other, they came from different areas of France, but they came one day apart on August 20th and 21st, Marie Lebranchu and Marie Lemarchand, who both were in the final stages of suffering with tuberculosis to such a degree, Cy, that Marie Lebranchu weighed less than 60 pounds. Her skin was literally hanging off of her. She was dying, dipped in the waters of Lourdes, and was healed instantaneously. And Marie Lemarchand was 18 years old, and she was so advanced that she too was emaciated and had cavernous holes in her face where the tuberculosis was literally eating the skin away, and there was actually a stench because of the pus and such that came from, wow, right?
Right.
She was dipped in those waters and healed instantaneous, and there's actually old grainy photos you can see before and after where she had no skin on her face, and afterwards she had the pure pink skin of a baby.
Yeah.
Right? Now, God doesn't do miracle shows, right? I mean, because as I also mentioned in my talk, Cy, he doesn't will to overwhelm our freedom. These are extraordinary events. God does it. It's just, he loves us so much, Cy.
Yeah.
He does this. But at the same time, he doesn't will to do too much of it because he doesn't want to overpower our wills, because our will is precious. And really, it's the safeguard for the existence of love. And without real freedom and the freedom to choose, we don't have love as we understand it. And so God, you know, he'll for those who don't want to believe miracles, there's a back door. You can always
find, that's something that struck me in your talk. You can always find a way to say, no, I reject it for this or that reason.
Even though the arguments can be weak to absurd.
Yeah, right.
But yeah, I mean, there is. It's a beautiful thing, though, when you consider it. And the last thing I'd say to the folks here is we need to learn about these miracles so that we can recount them to others. But you know what? They help us, too. Because, you know, this may be a secret. Don't tell anybody I said this, but sometimes I need to be encouraged in the faith, too.
I am shocked, Tim Staples.
We all do.
Right.
And when you see these miracles and read about them and then go and see them, I've been blessed to go to Italy and France a couple of times and see some of these miracles, man, it just gives you a shot in the arm.
The one that struck me, and I'm not ever going to forget it, is the little girl that Padre Pio called up when he at the conclusion of Mass.
Gemma Di Giorgi.
And she has no pupils.
Yes.
And yet he heals her, or, well, the Lord
through
heals
him,
her.
Yes.
Through him, okay. And she still doesn't have pupils.
That's right.
But she can see.
What's incredible is she is now 79 years old. Her name is Gemma Di Giorgi, and I did tell her story in the talk there. And to this day, I've seen photographs of her, and she still, it looks weird when you look at the photo, because it's the weirdest thing to see an eye with no pupil.
Yeah.
Because when I'm looking at you right now, in our, you know, it's kind of, you just expect to see that little black thing.
Right.
And when you look at somebody that doesn't have it, it's like, what?
Uh-huh.
What is that?
Wait a minute.
And can you imagine the eye doctor, Cy? Mm. She's in the eye, you know, in the doctor's office, and they put the chart up, And now you can't see because you don't have the physical, that little pupil there that's required, and yet she'll read that chart right off the wall. There, you have a living miracle.
Right.
That's
right.
How much God loves us.
Yeah, I've been inspired by you, Tim. Several times you've spoken about that, and the fact is we don't, as Catholics, talk enough about the miracles because they really do help people. They really do help people, and it's kind of ungenerous on our part to keep it hidden.
It is, and yet for some reason, I haven't figured this one out. Maybe you can help me, but especially among intellectuals, it's almost like they're beneath us.
Yeah.
We want to show our intellectual prowess, and let's talk about the proofs for the existence of God and the immortality of soul, which is great, and let's talk about that because we need to.
Right.
But I don't know, that it bothers me because, like I said, this is, and I'll leave the folks with this, as I mentioned at the end of my talk, Si, in John 10, Jesus, and he's a pretty good guy to follow.
Yes.
Jesus used miracles, and specifically for those who struggled. And you have that in John chapter 10, verse 30, where Jesus declares his divinity. I and the Father are one. And the people, not only did they have a little trouble with it, they wanted to kill him. They picked up rocks to kill him. And what is Jesus' response? If you go down to verses 37 and 38, Jesus in essence says, I know this is hard to believe, but if you can't believe my word, believe for the work's sake. In other words, Jesus was saying to them, have you seen anybody else walk on water lately, raise the dead lately,
right,
change or stop storms, and you name it, all the things. If you can't believe, believe for the sake of the works. And it's so important that we understand that. Believe for the sake of the miracles that we have in the church in every generation.
It is open forum today. If you've got a question for Tim, give us a call, 888-31-TRUTH, the number. And we're kicking off our annual fall store-wide sale this week. It's a great way to save money on all the great resources you hear about here on Catholic Answers Live, including Tim's book, Behold Your Mother. Enter promo code CALIVE18, CALIVE18 at checkout when you visit shop.catholic.com. Save 20% on almost everything in our online store, including all the Jimmy Akin stuff, Trent Horn's, Chris Check stuff, and as I said, Tim's stuff. That promo code, CALIVE18, visit shop.catholic.com today and begin your savings.
There's only one. Catholic Answers Live.
Father Larry Richards.
You know, I'm from the city of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and both of my parents, both of them, were police officers. My father was a police officer, and my mother was a police officer. They always thought I'd be a cop, too, and in some ways I am, a spiritual cop. But we keep doing what we do, and we come from wherever we come from, it doesn't matter. Where God is calling us is what's most important.
Open Line with Father Larry Richards, Thursday, 3 p.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious Mystic Monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All Mystic Monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase Mystic Monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, open forum. Tons of calls already, so we'll get to them. Tim Staples, our guest this hour. Let's start with Randy in Alberta, Canada, listening on Channel 130 Sirius XM Satellite Radio. That's EWTN. Randy, your question for Tim.
Yeah, I was just wondering, if Catholics believe that God is the author of all life, why would a Hindu family have 10 or 15 kids, or Muslim or whatever, how does that make sense? Or
sure,
do all people just go to heaven there?
Sure. Randy, great, great question. We do not believe as Catholics that only members of the Catholic Church, that is of the visible Catholic Church, are going to go to heaven. We believe that anyone, as Jesus says it in Matthew 7:7, ask and it shall be given. Seek and you shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened. St. Peter puts it this way in Acts 10:34-35. He says, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons, but anyone, any person in any nation who fears God and seeks him is acceptable to him. So, or that seeks God and works righteousness is acceptable to him. We believe that, Randy, as long as somebody doesn't reject the truth. Now, Randy, it doesn't matter if you're Catholic, Baptist, Hindu, Muslim. If you reject the truth, you will be lost. And now, Randy, we don't judge. See, we're not the judge. So we as Catholics, we do not. In fact, it's a sin for us to judge anybody's eternal destination. For me to say that that guy over there, oh, he's not going to heaven, that would be a sin. Because only God, 2 Chronicles chapter 6, verse 30 tells us, only God knows what's in the hearts of the children of men. St. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 through 6, he says, God alone knows what's inside of the hearts of men. And so God alone is the one who can judge. Now, as far as God, you know, being the author of life, absolutely. You know, St. Paul talks about on Mars Hill in Acts chapter 17, it's in him we live, move, and have our being. And that's true for everyone. Because God is the cause of all life, there's not a baby born here that God's not responsible for, right? God creates immediately the soul of every human being, no matter where they are, and he loves them infinitely, whether they're Hindu, Buddhist, or whatever. So, you know, God's not just going to bring Catholics alone into the world, but God loves us all, and he wills all ultimately. He wants every, as Carl Keating, our founder and president, used to say, I love this, I've stolen it from him for many years. He said, Jesus didn't establish a church just for the fun of it, but he wants everybody to be in it.
Yeah.
He wants everybody to be in it. And it's our job, Randy, to go out and to bring the fullness of the truth to everyone. Not judging those who don't have it, because that's not our role, but knowing that God wills all to have the what we call the ordinary means of sanctification. God sent his Son, gave us the seven sacraments, an infallible church, so that we can know the truth, we can have the ordinary means of sanctification that'll get us to heaven. That's the way to heaven. If folks outside get to heaven, it's by extraordinary means. We want everybody to have the ordinary means, the means that God wills. Because obviously, if you don't have that, you're lacking. If you don't have the Eucharist, Randy, I got news for you. You are lacking. You need Jesus in the Eucharist, because Jesus himself is the one who gave it to us to be, as the Catholic Church teaches, the source and summit of our faith, or as the great Saint Ignatius of Antioch said, the medicine of immortality. I love that. That's what Jesus gives to us. Does that get at your question, Randy?
Well, not really, because So if God gives a Muslim family 10 kids, and maybe one will become a Catholic or a believer in Christ.
Uh-huh.
So is God, does God know that beforehand, or just
absolutely? Randy, God knows. He can't not know any real thing that has ever or will ever happen. But here, Randy, I think we're getting into a little bit of the mystery of free will. God knew before he created Adam and Eve that they were going to choose to reject his plan and fall. And he knew all of the devastating consequences that would come of it. But that's part of the mystery of free will. God gave them free will, which means if God's going to create us as robots, he could have. He could have created us as robots to where all we could do is choose the good. But as we were talking about earlier, Randy, robots don't really love. Not, you know, in fact, they don't love at all. Because freedom is, there's something so profound about freedom, Randy, that God created both angels and men, the only rational creatures we're privy to. He created us with freedom so that they could choose, because that's at the heart of what love is. And so even though God knew Adam and Eve were going to fall, He created them anyway. Even though he knew Lucifer and one-third of the angels would fall, he created all of the angels and gave them that choice.
Randy, we'll leave it there. I hope that that is helpful to you. Thank you so much for that call, especially coming from, we'll start off coming from Canada. That's a good way to start the show. We go now to Amen. Chase in Harrisonburg, Virginia, watching on YouTube. Thanks for joining us on YouTube, Chase. Your question for Tim. Oh, hang on, Chase. A little error there. Someone forgot to push the button. No names.
Oh, you're good.
Oh, go ahead. Your question for Tim.
Thanks for what y'all do.
All right.
Yeah. So my question is a family member's question.
Yes.
Is Jesus just a God, little g, that we have made in the image of God?
Right.
Big G.
Right. Great question. And Chase, I would argue absolutely not. Because in fact, if one just looks at the historical evidence, Jesus was the last Messiah that any of the Jews were expecting, right? And he wasn't even the Messiah the apostles wanted, right?
Right.
They wanted an apostle. I mean, think about it. The Jews were expecting a king that would take over the Roman Empire. We reestablish, right, the temple and we'll dominate the world. And Jesus comes as a baby in a crib who is absolutely helpless and later would become absolutely helpless on a cross. Wait a minute, that's not the Messiah we were bargaining for. So the point I'm getting at here is Jesus was not the Messiah the Jews expected, even though it was right there in the Old Testament that yes, he would be that conquering king ultimately, but he was all, see, they kind of overlook Psalm 22 and Isaiah 53 and Wisdom chapter 2 and the text that talk about how he would suffer and die for our sins. Well, yeah, we don't like that part. We like the take over the world part.
Yeah.
And the same thing with the apostles themselves, right up until and even after the resurrection, they were still thinking, is he going to establish the kingdom now?
Right.
Right. That's how deeply ingrained these false notions of the Messiah was. So the point is here that Jesus is not what anybody expected. As a matter of history, this guy blew onto the scene as the God-man manifest in the flesh, made demands of us in the Sermon on the Mount that were impossible to fulfill. He challenges us beyond anything any prophet. I mean, the prophets say, the word of the Lord came unto me. This guy comes along and says, I am the word, right?
Right.
Jesus acted in ways that so far surpassed anything. This is not a creation of men. And that's the point you want to make to your family, is we didn't create Jesus. Jesus created us. He revealed the fact that he is God. And that is what has changed the entire world. Does that make sense, Chase?
Yeah, that helps.
But let me just say this too. What you have to do is approach it from a historical perspective. You don't have to approach it from the position of faith if your family are skeptics. Just from a historical perspective, you know, use the liar, lunatic, Lord approach of C.S. Lewis, which I think is excellent, although I add a fourth to that along with Dr. Peter Kraft or Guru. Because really you have to, he's either liar, lunatic, Lord, or Guru. That was one C.S. Lewis missed. But it's true. He is either a liar, because one of the central things he did was declare himself to be God. And if he wasn't, then he is either a colossal liar, my friend, because he knew he wasn't God and he claimed to be, or he is a lunatic. I love the way C.S. Lewis, as you probably know, Chase, I love the way C.S. Lewis, he is a lunatic to the order of one who would claim to be a poached egg, right? Because he claimed to be God, but he's not. Liar, lunatic, or guru. He says he's God, but he's really here to help us all to see that we're God, right? No, sorry. John chapter 8, verse 23 is one among many verses we could look at, but Jesus clearly says, I am from above, you are from beneath, right? Jesus distinguishes himself from all in John chapter 10, all who came before me are what, thieves and robbers, right? I am the door to the sheepfold. I am the way, the truth, and life. I mean, the claims that he made, it was not, oh, I'm just one among 124,000 avatars, right? I'm here to help you all to see that you're God. No, he is liar, lunatic, guru. You can eliminate all of those. The only thing left is he is Lord. And that is how Jesus established it to be. He didn't want there to be another possibility.
Chase, you can probably hear that music. That means we got to go to a break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Tim Staples, our Director of Apologetics and Evangelization, right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Bishop Chad Zielinski from the Diocese of Fairbanks of Northern Alaska, and you are listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Hard Sayings, A Catholic Approach to Answering Bible Difficulties, is the new book by apologist Trent Horn. A comprehensive look at dozens of the most confounding passages in Scripture that offers clear, reasonable, and Catholic keys to unlocking their true meaning. Don't be left without an answer again. Order your copy of Hard Sayings today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
A generation ago, Christian parents didn't have to worry about how to explain transgenderism to their 9-year-old or help their teenager deal with mockery at school for believing in traditional marriage. But today, as our culture's moral center continues to fly apart and with every form of deviance publicly aired and celebrated, we have no choice but to equip our kids to understand about such issues. In Made This Way, How to Prepare Kids to Face Today's Tough Moral Issues, Layla Miller and Trent Horn give parents the crucial tools and techniques to form children with the understanding they need, appropriate to their age and maturity level, to meet the world's challenges. Silence can no longer be an option. If we're not teaching our children how to understand tough moral issues, then the world will. Read Made This Way and learn how to give your kids a firm foundation on which to build a life of moral clarity and happiness. Order your copy of Made This Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000 or logging on to the shop at Catholic.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Tim Staples, our guest. He's the author of many things, including Behold Your Mother, A Biblical and Historical Defense of the Marian Doctrines. We were talking when we went to the break with Chase in Harrisonburg, Virginia, and Chase wanted to ask another question. So are you still there with us, Chase?
Yes, I am.
All right, you had a follow-up. Go ahead.
Yeah, I really appreciate everything Tim was saying, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to ask the follow-up question.
Sure.
I guess one of my family members' issue thinking about Jesus being God, I mean, first of all, they're coming from a Muslim background,
right?
Is that maybe God is too all-knowing and all-powerful, and this was addressed in the question that you answered, Tim,
sure,
with the person who called before me,
yes,
that, like, God is so all-powerful, all-knowing, he's all these things that perhaps we've projected our ideas of this great, like, love, like this great loving persona or whatnot,
right,
that would even allow free will and all these things. Like, I guess that was kind of where,
yeah,
they were coming from with the heart of that question, perhaps. At least that's my
sure. Oh, that, you know what, Chase? I didn't know you were coming from that Muslim perspective, because yeah, I can absolutely hear that, especially from the Sunni. You know, as you know, the Sunni, which make up about 85% of Muslims, are very much we would say, like Calvin, total predestination. God is so far beyond us that we can't even know him. We can't know his will. We can't, you know, there's such an emphasis on that God is almighty, that free will is an absolute farce, that concept. Now, among the Shia, they do believe in free will. It's fascinating to learn, you know, the way the Shia and the Sunni fight with the, and of course some of the Sunni fight with each other and Shia fight with each other too, but that's one major difference between the Sunni and the Shia, along with things like with the Sunni, the Quran is the uncreated word of God. Of course, the Shia call that the sin of shirk. They're putting the Quran on the level with God, and boy, that causes all kinds of problems. Anyway, I chase a rabbit there, Chase. But the bottom line is, yes, there is this belief, especially among the Sunni, but even among Shia in general, that the idea of the incarnation or God, you know, as you see in the Quran, God having a son is absurd, right? And of course, Muhammad did not understand what we mean by that, God having a son. He thought that means there are two beings, which is not true. The distinction among the persons of the Trinity is one of relation, not of essence. There is only one God. We agree with the Muslims on that. There is only one God, but he is revealed something about his inner life that we could not know in any other way because it's infinitely beyond us. He has revealed in Jesus Christ that he is three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So really, Chase, this comes down to a disagreement over the nature of revelation. Now, we can argue with the Muslim all day of how what we're saying is not irrational, it's not contrary to even the Muslim understanding of there being one God. If we have time, we can reason with them about that and help them to see. And believe me, I've done this many times with Muslims over the years. I've had friends that are Muslim. I've been to Muslim country before, and it can be done. But I think ultimately, Chase, what this gets down to is, what do you believe about Jesus? And I argue that, in fact, I have a CD set that I did when I was with St. Joseph Communications, and it's still available over there, called Islam Exposed, where I go into a lot of detail about this. But from a historical perspective, you can demonstrate to that Muslim that if you're going to be a good Muslim and really listen to the Quran, Muhammad himself said you need to listen to the Injil, I-N-J-I-L, which is the gospel, and those who had the revelation before you. Muhammad said that in the Quran. And the fact is that, you know, as you may have heard, Muslim scholars will talk about the doctrine of tahrif, which is corruption, and that the gospels have been corrupted. That's not what Muhammad said. That comes later. Muhammad said the Jews and the Christians are like donkeys. They carry these great tomes on their backs, but they don't know what they mean. He never said that the gospel was corrupted. He said you need to follow it, right? It's just that the Christians don't know what it is. Well, guess what? We know what that gospel is that Muhammad was talking about. Why? Because we have manuscripts that predate him by 400 years. And parts of manuscripts even further than that. And the fact is, what is revealed in that gospel that Muhammad says you should listen to is the truth about free will, that Jesus is God manifest in the flesh, and that he in fact did come to reveal to us that infinite mystery that is God, incarnate in the flesh, so that we could see him and touch him and one day live with him forever. It's radical stuff, but it can be done.
Chase, thank you very, very much. I appreciate those questions and that call. We move now to Carol in Michigan, listening on Holy Family Radio. Carol, your question for Tim Staples.
Hi there. I actually have two. I'm going to reverse the order. My first question is, did Mary know that she was free from sin?
Yeah, that is a great question. There's nothing in the revelation or in the teaching of the church that gives that answer away. And so while I would not argue, now this is just Tim Staples, Mary would not have had any consciousness of her sinning because she never did. But whether, you know, did she know from the time she's a little girl that she is free from all sin? That's a question that you know, good Catholics could disagree about. Now, having said that, I do believe many of the private revelations, this is just Tim Staples, that, you know, she would have had visitations from angels from the time she was a kid, in my humble opinion. And this is one of the reasons why, when the angel Gabriel appears to her in Luke chapter 1, she talks with the angel just like you, me and Cy are talking.
Yeah.
You know, St. Athanasius in the 4th century says of this, he says, Mary, this is one of the ways she shows her glorious nature, is she converses with the angel like Cy and I are talking, whereas the prophets of old, or those, whether it's Abraham or John the Apostle in Revelation 19 and Revelation 22, when angels appear, John the Apostle is on his face.
Yeah, right.
In John 19, verse 10, it's almost comical. John falls on his face and starts worshiping the angel, and the angel has to say, Ora me, in Greek, which means literally, see not. Or we would say, knock it off, right? Because I'm a servant of Jesus like you. And you can picture John getting up and dusting himself off, but gee, you know, Mr. Angel, you're really awesome. 3 chapters later, the angel appears again, and John does another nosedive, right? And, you know, this is not to pick on John, because we're talking about an angel who is by nature so far superior to us that it does require discernment whether, you know, and that angel is a demon. In fact, Father Benedict Rochelle, in one of his books, I mentioned it during the Q&A at the conference, I think it's Still Small Voice, as I recall. But Father Rochelle relates a story of where St. Catherine of Siena had what she thought the Blessed Mother appeared to her, and it turned out to be a demon. But it took time for her. She didn't know it right away.
Yeah.
It took time for her to discern. So this is, you know, angels are so far superior to us, and yet when the angel appears to Mary, notice Mary's not greatly troubled because an angel appeared to her, right? When the angel says, Hail, full of grace, the Lord is with thee, right? The scripture says Mary was greatly disturbed at what manner of salutation this may be.
This is not how you usually talk to me, in other words.
That's right.
Why are you talking to me like this?
That's right. It's like, hey, what? You know, so again, we're into the speculative realm here, but my personal take would be that Mary would have known that she was the prophetic woman of Genesis 3:15. I believe she would have had angel visitations and such. She wouldn't have had full understanding, and the scripture makes clear about that fact, because in both Luke 2:19 and Luke 2:51, it explicitly says Mary did not understand along with Joseph, but she pondered these things in her heart, which reveals to us, even though she didn't have full understanding of all the gifts surrounding what it meant for her to be that chosen one and this or that, but she pondered these things in her heart, which revealed to us she had a unique knowledge. And so by the time of the foot of the cross, I believe she would have been perfected in suffering in union with her son, and would have reached a level that you and I could never even fathom. I'm sorry, I probably gave you more than you bargained for there.
Carol, we got to do the second question very quickly because we're right up against a break.
Okay, thank you. The next question is, there's a lot of things going on in the background right after Jesus dies on the cross. The veil is torn, and then it talks about bodies coming out of the tombs and coming back to life.
Yes.
I've never heard anybody talk about that. Was that right to scare people? Was that a good thing?
Yes, that was a good thing. And that is a powerful symbol of the fact of what happened when Jesus died on the cross. The veil was torn asunder. As you know, the book of Hebrews tells us that was a sign to show that the way into the Holy of Holies was now made available. That Holy of Holies in that temple was only a shadow. It wasn't the real Holy of Holies. This was a symbol of now you have the true access into the Holy of Holies, which is into the very inner life of God himself through Jesus Christ. So that's what's most important there. And then, of course, the dead being raised approximate to this time, shows that Jesus overcame death. And there we have a sacramental, if you will, a visible sign of that conquering of death with the mummies walking out of the tombs. I guarantee you that woke some folks up.
But I was thinking of maybe they visited some people that they knew.
Like, they probably did.
Yeah,
they went into the city and
right.
and spoke with people, and people testified to the fact that they were raised from the dead, showing that Jesus Christ has triumphed over death.
Thanks, Carol, for those questions. Right now, Catholic Answers Magazine, when you order, you get a free digital subscription added to your order, absolutely free. That's just about a $20 value for absolutely free. You just go to CatholicAnswersMagazine.com to subscribe. It's one of the best Catholic magazines you will find anywhere. I know that you will agree with me when you read it. It's just a tremendous magazine each time. They put it out here. Tim Ryland, the editor, does a magnificent job. We'd love you to have it. And when you subscribe right now, you get a digital subscription added, a $20 value added for free. Go to CatholicAnswersMagazine.com and subscribe.
Catholic Answers Live. The only thing missing from today's broadcast is you. Call now with your question.
Listeners to Catholic Radio, I think, benefit most, at least initially, from what I call remedial catechesis. What Catholic Radio does is it becomes an echo chamber for the teaching authority of the Catholic Church. And what we're doing is teaching many things which have been neglected over the last 40, 50 years. If you listen to Catholic Radio, you know what the Catholic Church teaches.
Al Cresta thinks Catholic Radio is important. So should you.
Go forth and preach the good news. It's not just a suggestion. If you want to take more seriously the command of Jesus to share the gospel with those around you, consider joining St. Paul Street Evangelization. It's a grassroots organization that brings the Catholic faith to the streets in a non-confrontational way. Visit our website, www.streetevangelization.com, to learn more. And don't forget to like us on Facebook. It's time to do our part.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Tim Staples, our guest, both hours today. That means lots and lots of fun for this Tuesday afternoon. Happy to have you with us. Thanks for being with us. And open
Cy,
floor. Yes.
Can I just say I love this bumper music? This is great.
Did you know it's new?
No, I didn't. When did we start it?
At the conference on Friday.
It's great.
So second hour Friday. We started playing it, and then we played it yesterday, and we're going to play it forever now.
Wow. I think this is a step way up.
How do you like that, Nick and Darren? Fine work that you two did getting this new bumper music and theme yes. music for Catholic Answers. We're going to use it for the TV show, too. Do you know we do a TV show?
Yes. And, you know, I was on Thursday at the conference, so you guys didn't get...
No, we had the old music for Thursday. Right. We decided...
Because you don't like me? Is that it?
Well, that was part of it. I mean, well, that was the main reason, yeah.
Yes.
Open forum means you can ask any question you want about the Catholic faith, and Tim will be happy to answer them. If you have questions more generally about God and religion, those are welcome as well. You can be Catholic. You can be non-Catholic. Everybody's welcome. 888-318-7884. We go now to George in Alabama. Listening to Sirius Satellite Channel 130. That's EWTN. George, your question for Tim.
Well, it's awkward because I've called in many times and I miss the old music. Old music. I guess I'll get used to the new.
Wait, George is breaking up. Sorry, we can't hear you, George. We'll get you. Call back another day, George.
I love it. No, he'll get.
I'm just kidding, you, George.
Can you hear me now?
Go ahead. We can hear you fine. I was just messing with you. Go ahead,
okay.
George.
So my question is, I'm Catholic, and I've done some independent reading, because I've always thought, you know, it's good to, you know, learn about your faith. But so I came across a writer who I've heard for Richard Carrier, and, I just read his stuff just because
yes.
why not? This should be interesting. He says that St. Paul, and he says, I've searched the epistles, and I cannot find a clear statement where St. Paul says that Jesus was actually human, but rather he was crucified and suffered in the heavens, like a Greek or a Roman god would.
Wow.
Of course, you know, and I couldn't find much on the internet to, you know, refute this, maybe because it is a fringe theory. Maybe it's not even worth people's time, but, you know, how could you respond
sure.
to that?
Oh, my goodness. The reason why, and I agree with you that this is fringe, is because, in fact, in the first century, some of the most powerful heresies were not so much denying Jesus' divinity as denying his humanity, and this is why, his full humanity, and this is why St. Paul and St. John are actually so clear on the point. So, George, a couple things come to mind immediately. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5, this is St. Paul, and St. Paul says, there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Jesus Christ. There is no way you're going to get any more plain that Jesus is fully man than to say the man Jesus Christ. And then I would also toss out this. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 10, one of the most beautiful pericopes in all the Pauline letters, St. Paul says, Christ, though he was in the form of man, though he was in the form of God, thought his equality with God not something to be clung to. Now, that's a very important point. So he's acknowledging that Christ is God, right? When he was in the form of God, in forme theou, in the form of God, meaning he's God, he thought his equality with God not something to be clung to. Again, he is God, he's equal with God, but emptied himself, taking upon himself the form of a slave. That's doulos in Greek, the bond slave of Deuteronomy chapter 15, you know, who, oh, that's a whole nother story, that would take too long. But, and then being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself unto death, even the death on the cross. And therefore God hath exalted him and given him a name above every name, that at the name of Jesus Christ every knee should bend, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So the point is, again, clearly, multiple, I just quoted three different times where St. Paul says he is man. Do you think that helps?
Yes, sir. I appreciate it. I'm a big fan of Catholic Answers, so.
All right, brother.
Any good questions of mine, so thank you.
All right, and thank you for asking, my brother, because you know what? We have learned over the years that every one of these questions that people ask, there is a lot more folks who have the same question and have that answered for them as well.
And thanks for saying you're a big fan of Catholic Answers new music, George.
Yeah. Yes, I'll get used to the new one, I'm sure.
Bye, George.
<Thank you.
laughs> Let's go to Angel in Anaheim watching on Facebook Live. Thanks for watching on Facebook Live. Angel, your question for Tim Staples.
Hi. The question I have is in Romans chapter 16, verse 1, it says, I commend to you our sister Phoebe, who is a deaconess of the Church of Cenchrea.
Yes.
Cenchrea.
Yes.
What exactly was a deaconess,
right,
and when did we stop having deaconesses in our church? Would we bring them back, or
right? Okay, great
explanation on that.
Great question. Well, the deaconess there is not an ordained deacon, and in fact, diakone in Greek can simply mean servant. Jesus is referred to as servant. The word diakonos is used for servants in many different contexts. So she was a servant, a helper. And we know in the early church we had servants or deaconesses, and they were used, for example, to help with baptisms of women, because normally when people were baptized, they removed all of their clothing and all they had was a white gown on. And so for propriety, women would help with the baptism rather than men, and these were deaconesses. They were servants, but they were not ordained. In fact, at the Council of Nicaea, made that clear, that the deaconesses were not and never have been ordained. And so when we talk about deaconess, we have deaconesses, if you will, in that sense, in all sorts of ministries and apostolic endeavors that are fulfilled by women. But when it comes to the ordained, and here's a key point, in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, or verse 12, actually, back up to verse 12, St. Paul says, I do not allow, remember, this is the same St. Paul who wrote Romans chapter 16. He says, I allow not the woman to teach nor usurp authority over the man, for it was not the woman, but the man who was created first, then the woman, and it was not the man who was in transgression, but the woman. Now, this is this is not misogyny, by the way. He's merely establishing here that there is an order to creation, and we have a principle in Catholic theology that says grace builds on nature. There's an order to creation. The man was created first. He is the transcendent one. Paul will talk about that in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 3 and 7. He'll talk about, especially verse 7, how the man is the glory of God, the woman is the glory of man. That's not to put women down. It's not. It's to show there is an order to creation. The man is the transcendent one, right? He is first, and the woman comes from him. So the man symbolizes better God. That's what he means. The man is the glory of God. Why? Because we're the man. Think of the conjugal act. The man delivers the seed. He acts from the outside in, right? That's what it means to be the transcendent authority. He is the first, the transcendent one. The woman receives the seed and brings forth life. She is the one who better represents the creation, the church. She's Mary is the archetype of the church and such. So we're just talking about different roles here, what St. Paul is getting at. And that's what he's getting at in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 12 here, and that leads right into his discussion about the ordaining of bishops and deacons in chapter 3, which he reserves to men. Now, deaconesses are a reality, as you pointed out here, but they were not ordained. Why? Because one of the roles of the deacon is to deliver the seed. One of the, principal purposes of a deacon is actually the proclamation of the gospel in a liturgical setting. And that's the context of 1 Timothy 2. And by the way, when he says he allows not women to teach nor usurp authority of them, it doesn't mean women can't teach. In fact, in 1 Corinthians 11, he says when women teach, they should wear a veil to show their submission. So obviously he's not saying they can't teach, but the context is a liturgical setting to be the official proclaimer of the gospel liturgically in the context of a church setting and in the context of holy orders, which he is about to talk about in 1 Timothy 3. And so that's why in the tradition of the church, in fact, Pope Francis talked about this not long ago when the question came up about deaconesses. He said, it is my understanding that the deaconesses were never ordained. And he was right on that. And that's not a put down to women. No, it simply shows, as I said before, the difference of roles. And you know what? I'll leave you with one last thought here. When we talk about the roles of man and woman, if you look at the conjugal act, for example, Cy, if we're going to argue who has the more important role, it drives me crazy, how our culture, we think everything's power. The guy sitting up there, that's the power, right? And so right. We all want the power. We want the power, right? But that's not the way God sees things, and it shouldn't be the way we see things, because think about the conjugal act. It's the man who delivers the seed. The woman receives the seed, nurtures it for 9 months, and brings life. Which one is more important? I think we men lose that argument every time, because the role of being the receptive one, receiving the seed and bringing forth life in the parish, is in fact more important, right, in many ways than the one who delivers the seed and certainly brings life to the community. At any rate, it's not about more or less. It's about different roles.
Angel, thanks so much for that call. If you're on the line, stay on the line. If you haven't called yet, 888-31-TRUTH is the number. Tim Staples will be here with us for another hour of Open Forum right here on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers YouTube channel. New subscribers welcome.
Wouldn't it be great to have a book to give to anyone to explain exactly why Catholics believe what we believe? The good news is now there is. Why We're Catholic is the groundbreaking new resource by apologist Trent Horn, that one book you can hand to anyone as a starting point for helping them find their way into or back to the practice of the Catholic faith. In a series of short, easy-to-read chapters, Trent covers the whole range of common topics, starting with why we believe in anything at all and answering all the common objections to the Catholic faith, both doctrinal and moral. Don't miss out on the most important, life-changing book to come along in years. Better yet, it's only $3 a copy when you order in bulk. Order your copies of Why We're Catholic today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
A generation ago, Christian parents didn't have to worry about how to explain transgenderism to their 9-year-old children or help their teenager deal with mockery at school for believing in traditional marriage. But today, as our culture decays, we have to know how to talk to our children about these issues. In Made This Way, How to Prepare Kids to Face Today's Tough Moral Issues, Layla Miller and Trent Horn give parents the crucial tools and techniques to form children with the understanding they need, appropriate to their age and maturity level, to meet the world's challenges. If we're not teaching our children how to understand tough moral issues, then the world will. Read Made This Way and learn how to give your kids a firm foundation on which to build a life of moral clarity and happiness. Order your copy of Made This Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000 or logging onto the shop at Catholic.com.
Catholic Answers Live.
Is the church wrong on contraception? In a culture that worships the pursuit of sexual pleasure, the Catholic Church's teaching on contraception can seem archaic and unintelligible. Its critics say it's outdated, theologically unfounded, and even harmful. And even faithful Catholics can have difficulty explaining this moral teaching. Catholic Answers is out to change all of that. That's why we've just released Trent Horn's dynamic new DVD, The Case Against Contraception. Using scripture, papal and magisterial teachings, natural law, and new insights provided by social science and medicine, Trent puts forward a compelling case for Catholic teachings with his trademark charity and persuasive graciousness. Be prepared to give a defense. Order your copy of The Case Against Contraception today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you. We as Catholics need to stand strong, to be prepared to mount a daily defense, to respond to the many challenges that we, as believers, are presented with every day. Jimmy Akin is here to help. His innovative new book, A Daily Defense, takes up a different challenge for every day of the year, 366 in all, teaching you how you can defend the faith and give answers to Catholics and skeptics alike. And it's user-friendly, with challenges and answers indexed alphabetically, so finding the answers can be quick and easy. Order your copy of A Daily Defense today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Hi, this is Trent Horn, and you've probably heard me explain Catholicism to non-Catholic callers on the radio or engage opponents in formal public debates. I've always hoped these interactions would show people how to graciously defend and share our faith, but they're not enough. That's why I've created a weekly podcast that will help Catholics answer the toughest objections against our faith. Every episode of the Council of Trent will provide listeners with a conversation roadmap that will help them share their faith with anyone. Keep in mind that I hate boring lectures. These podcasts will contain entertaining, informative, and practical explanations of the faith, as well as interviews with the best Catholic writers and speakers in the world today. Visit TrentHornPodcast.com today to find out how you can subscribe to my new podcast. That's TrentHornPodcast.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host, joined in studio by Tim Staples, the Director of Apologetics and Evangelization here at Catholic Answers, the author of Behold Your Mother, A Biblical and Historical Defense of the Marian Doctrines. He also wrote the 20 Answers book on Mary, so he's got the Mary thing covered, I'm pretty sure. And a bunch of people, I wish I had written down the names because I don't have them in front of me now, but a bunch of people on Facebook saying they're looking forward to you, Tim Staples, flying across the Pacific and being with them in Australia next week. It's in a week?
In 1 week. I'm going to be there from the 9th, that is October 9th, through the 21st. So, oh my gosh, I was just going over with Jen Phelps, our conference coordinator here at Catholic Answers, the schedule. And, Cy, I'm going to earn my keep.
You are. Good for you. Traveling halfway around the world.
That's right. I told him, as long as I'm there, put me to work. I'm not here to chase kangaroos, man. I want to preach the gospel. And they said, okay.
Okay, Tim. By the way, 30 talks a day. Well, when you fly from here to there, how long does it take you to kind of like get your bearings? I think I might. I've never flown that far, but I feel like I might take a day to get my bearings.
It does. And normally I take a day with no talks, although this time we're hitting the ground. First night I'm there, I'm going right into it and giving two talks.
Really?
Actually, I decided to throw in an extra one. And they were great. They said, look, if you don't want to, you don't have to. And I said, let's just go for it. Look, I can sleep when I get back to the United States. Let's do it. So, I mean, we're talking, I'm going to Sydney, Brisbane, Melbourne, then flying across to Perth, man. It is going to be awesome. And I'm doing talks on everything from proving the existence of God to the papacy, to Mary, to Eucharist, to salvation, and more. It's going to be covering the gamut all over Aussie land.
And Father Larry will be with you, or are you guys traveling there together? You'll be together the whole time?
Not the whole time. We separate. I think I forget exactly, like when I'm in Sydney, he's in Melbourne and vice versa or something like that. And then we meet up in Perth. And we have 3 days together where we're going to do joint conferences, and I can't wait. I absolutely love Father Larry. He is just the greatest guy.
He doesn't come across a little girly to you?
No, exactly. Yeah, he's not the girly priest, that's for sure.
That's cool. I meant to ask you about this too, and I was going to just ask you about it off the air, but we're here now, so I'll just ask you. Did your boys... I saw you at Mass on Sunday, the big Mass at the... Did they have suits that match your suit? It looked like the three of you were wearing matching suits.
It just happened to work out that way. Oh. It wasn't planned. But yeah, that is true, because I think I had my black suit on and they had theirs, yeah.
Yes, handsome fellas. Yeah, that was you were there.
Except
with
for
your
tribe. Little guy now. The little guy, Anthony, he had his gray.
Yeah.
He had his gray suit on. So yeah. Anthony, for those of you who don't know, Timmy's 14, Luke is 12, Anthony is just turned 4. And he had a gray one, but the big three, the other three, we were in our black suits. I have 4 girls and 3 boys, and we took the whole tribe to the conference on Sunday.
Yeah, it was nice to see them too. I don't know how I ended up behind you ended up behind you all at the end of the Mass, and they're just lovely, Tim.
I appreciate that.
Lovely kids.
God is good.
God is good. Mary Jo in Nebraska wants to talk to you.
Sure. And one other thing about my kids, the beatings work.
I saw them beating you a few times, but I didn't.
Yes.
Mary Jo from Nebraska listening on Spirit Catholic Radio. You are up next. Your question for Tim Staples.
Hi, thank you.
Hi, Mary Jo.
Yes.
My question, in the New Testament, is there are multiple stories of Jesus and or his disciples casting out demons.
Yes.
It seems like there must have been a lot of possessed people then.
Mm-hmm.
So how does that compare to now, or were some of those they were just sick with illnesses that they cast out, or
that's a great question, and you know there's different schools of thought on this. My take is yes, because we had the incarnation of our Lord and Savior, the victory over the kingdom of darkness is occurring. The devil threw everything he had at the Messiah. And so I do believe that, in the first century there would have been an uptick, if you will, and dramatically so, of demonic possessions. Now some folks argue, well, we're just getting snippets, we're getting snapshots in the Gospels of possessed folks. If you only had these few snapshots of possessions today, we could have a lot more than what you see there in the Gospels. So, and you know, I've read those who make that argument, but I do believe it's because of the incarnation and the fact that Jesus is God. And I love the way, in fact, Father Hugh Barber, our chaplain here not long ago, was giving a homily, and he mentioned Cardinal Journet, who, you know, one of the truly great theological minds of the 20th century, who made the point that one of the reasons for the increased miracles in the first century is not only the presence of Jesus, but also the presence of the Ark of the Covenant, Mary. She was on this earth, and just as you see in the Old Testament, whenever the Ark was present, the power of God is present. So there you have, you had Jesus on this earth, and then Mary was still on this earth as the Ark of the Covenant with the apostles, hence the powerful manifestations of both God and the enemy. I find that to be compelling as well. But here, one very important point, though. It is clear in the Gospels, for example, if you look at Matthew chapter 4, verse 25, I remember when I was in Greek class in the seminary, we were translating Matthew's Gospel, and my old spiritual director, Father Patrick Brannan, God rest his soul, brilliant Greek scholar, he made this point. If you go to Matthew 4, verse 24 and 25, it says, I'm going to read this to you. So Jesus' fame spread throughout all Syria, and they brought him all the sick, those afflicted with various diseases and pains, demoniacs, epileptics, and paralytics, and he healed them all. Now, what's interesting here is, you know, when it says epileptic, it's actually the Greek word is where we get the word lunatic. It's literally lunatics. So epileptic is not really the best translation.
Oh, okay.
But it's actually lunatic, those with mental problems. And so I bring that up to say this. Certainly Jesus knew absolutely, because he's God. And as John chapter 2, verse 25 says, he did not need anyone to tell him anything about anyone, because he knew all men and he knew what was in all men. And so Jesus obviously knew the difference between the lunatic, or the one with mental ailments, and those that were possessed. But we also, I think, need to add to that equation, the gospel here clearly makes the distinction between those that are diseased, that is physically, that have ailments, those who have mental ailments, and those who are demonically possessed. And when it comes to the apostles, now they weren't God like Jesus to where they had perfect knowledge all the time, but they were apostles, and they, you know, were the greatest Christians that have ever walked, had the fullness of the revelation that God deigned to reveal to us in their heads. I mean, they had revelation, as Paul himself describes it. He was caught up into the third heaven and heard things unlawful for him to even utter. What does that mean? I don't even know, but whatever, it sounds incredible. So the apostles, of course, St. Paul knew the difference between one who is possessed and one who is playing games, like Simon, your money perish with thee, right? For I perceive your heart is not right with God. Actually, that wasn't Paul, that was Peter in Acts chapter 8, verses 14 through 17, talking to Simon, you know, when he said, I want to buy this power to confirm, right? Your money perish with thee. I perceive your heart is not right in the sight of God. So Peter knew, hey, this isn't demons here. This is your heart is not right with God. But Peter also cast out demons, as did Paul. And so when we're looking at the New Testament, I think it's important for us to understand that these guys had it right. these are the apostles, and we're really aiming to get back in our endeavors, to be like Peter and the apostles, right? We're not adding anything. They had the fullness of the revelation. And so, you know, I always like to point that out to folks who say, oh, but yeah, they were scientifically lacking and this and that. And yes, they were. They didn't have cell phones, Cy. Did you know that?
I was not aware of that.
Yeah, it's unbelievable.
That's
but
like,
they did
like
not
the
have
dark
cell
ages
phones.
Or something.
They didn't have cell phones, but they knew the human person and they knew God better than we do. Does that help at all?
Yes, it does. Thank you.
All right. God
Thank
bless you,
Mary Jo. Appreciate that question.
Thank you.
888-318-7884 is our number. 888-318-7884. Once again, I'll remind you, we're kicking off our annual fall store-wide sale this week, and it's a great way to save money on all the great resources you hear about here on Catholic Answers Live. All you have to do is enter a promo code. The promo code is CALIVE18 at checkout when you visit shop.catholic.com, and you save 20% off almost everything in our online store, almost everything there. Promo code CALIVE18 at shop.catholic.com.
Stay with us for more Catholic Answers Live.
Pope Francis reminds us that it does not take a specialized degree in theology to become a great evangelist. We're all called to evangelize. Think about the woman at the well. After she encountered Jesus, she immediately went into the city and invited others to meet him as she had. You and I can go out now and do the same. And St. Paul Street Evangelization can help. Get involved today by contacting us at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
The leading Catholic voices are on EWTN Radio.
The Church has 2,000 years of wisdom to share on what it takes to live life gracefully.
We're so overwhelmed by how much our faith has transformed our marriage and family especially. We want everyone to experience the incredible gift that the Catholic vision of life and love really is.
More to Life with Dr. Greg and Lisa Popchak. Tomorrow morning, 10 Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Open forum. Tim Staples, our guest for both hours, and lots of calls. So I'm going to go quickly, I think is how I'll go. Jeffrey in Connecticut, watching on Facebook Live. You are up next with Tim Staples. Jeffrey, your question, please.
Hi, Tim. First, yes. Thank you for your service. Thank you for going to the men's conference last year. I have a question about mortal sin.
Yes.
Basically, I've been diagnosed with various clinical conditions.
Right.
And I'm wondering, when can I discern my full consent of my will?
Right. Well, in those cases, Jeffrey, where, you know, I don't know what your particular malady is, but that's something that really has to be worked out in spiritual direction. Because really all that I could say from afar, Jeffrey, is that the Catholic Church teaches that in order for something to be mortal, it must be objectively grave, and the person acting must do so freely, that is, with deliberate consent of the will, and he has to have knowledge that what he is about to act upon is objectively grave matter. No one can accidentally commit sin. I mean, not even venial sin. You can't accidentally commit even a venial sin. There has to be the deliberate consent of the will. But when it comes to mortal sin, all the more. There has to be that deliberate consent. Now, there can be all sorts of mitigating factors, including mental disorders, habits that, see, you can have a mental disorder that can impact your ability to comprehend truth. That can impede you because of a lack of knowledge. Most often, though, there's an impediment to the will so that the will is not fully engaged. Now, in order to discern that, it really does take a priest. We always recommend folks here at Catholic Answers to go to spiritual direction or at least go to confession and talk to a priest, because you need to be able to get into particulars that we really wouldn't want to do from afar. It's really matter for a confessor or a spiritual director. But the key principle here, Jeffrey, for all of our listeners, is to discern whether there is some sort of impediment when it comes to either that intellectual knowledge or, most importantly, the act of the will. Habit, as you know, Jeffrey, can cause someone's will to be so directed toward a particular sin that even though they want to, gosh, I don't want to do this anymore, they're so habituated in it that it overpowers the will. I mean, never completely, but to the point where there is mitigated culpability, right? And that can happen simply by habit. But when it comes to disorders, that's a whole nother animal. You know, scrupulosity, for example, is, you know, a problem that folks have that can lead to mitigating factors as well. But gosh, you know, I wish I could go a little bit more than that. But Jeffrey, trust me, get a good spiritual director or even go to confession if you know a good holy priest, and they can really help you with the particular sins and situations.
Okay, Jeffrey?
Thank you.
Thank you. God bless you, brother. Let's go to Dennis in Virginia, listening on the Catholic Answers app. Hey, Dennis, thanks for downloading the app onto your phone. Your question for Tim Staples.
Tim and Cy, good to speak to you again. Cy, is the Thursday groovy music still safe?
I do not know. Nick and I will have to have a talk about that. Thank you for asking. An important question, but I don't know. You got anything for Tim, or were you just worried about the groovy music?
My real question is, understanding that Canon 932 and Redemptionis Sacramentum, paragraph 108, does allow the bishop to permit a Mass to be celebrated outdoors when there's a necessity.
Yes.
Can it be considered a necessity to cancel the normal Masses on Sunday to have Mass at a parish picnic outdoors? If that's problematic, can we be considered dispensed for not going that day? The priest did not talk to the diocese for permission until after it was brought up, and even then they didn't discuss if the picnic itself was a necessity, only that, you know, hey, under necessity, it can be done outside.
Right. Yeah, that is definitely the call, a call for the bishop. And when you talk about necessity, you know, I think a lot of times we can interpret that a little bit too narrowly. I'm going to give you an example. When I was a youth, well, we used to call them youth ministers. I don't know what we call them now, because you can't use the term minister anymore. But back when I was a youth minister many years ago, in fact, it was Father Hugh Barber, who is now our chaplain here, who I employed to give my confirmandi a retreat, and we went up into the mountains and we did an outdoor Mass. But of course we got the permission of the bishop to do that, and Father Hugh Barber is a remarkably traditional priest and did a phenomenal job, even with wind blowing up in the mountains and everything. He did a phenomenal job. But there can be situations where a bishop simply has ongoing permission. It's not necessarily true that each particular time you have to get permission. For example, the retreat house that we went to, they had permission from the bishop to do that for these special retreats. It may be, and see, I don't know your situation, but it may be that the bishop has given permission. If he hasn't given permission, a pastor may act with the knowledge of his bishop. That gets a little tricky, doesn't it? To say, you know what, the bishop, I know Bishop John, he's going to say yes, and we've got this situation here, and we're going to do it. And he does that, and then he later talks to the bishop, and the bishop says, yeah, that's fine. These things happen. Oh. So, and it's not a thing where, oh, you were wrong because you didn't get permission, and that's a sin, and I'm not going to, see, I'll tell you, my take on this, Dennis, is that we as lay people are the least who should worry about this. Because really, if Father does a mass for the parish and it's outdoor for a picnic and such, you can go to that mass. And let's say it was, you find out later, oh, the bishop came down hard on Father and said, don't you ever do that again. That is not even slightly on you. And if you attended that mass, you are not culpable for anything. You're part of a parish. You're there to worship God and to receive our Lord in the Eucharist. So, you know, I would argue, and certainly there's nothing in the law at all that says any parishioner is culpable for going to a mass like that.
Dennis, we'll leave it there because I do want to try to get as many in as I can before the end of the hour. Thank you for that call. John in Wisconsin, listening on the Guadalupe Radio app. I haven't heard of the Guadalupe Radio app before, but I'm glad they got one. We love the people at Guadalupe Radio. Your question, John.
All right, Tim, I think I've got a new one for you.
Okay.
So see if I can stump you. So since Mary is the new and antithesis of Eve, and Jesus is the new and antithesis of Adam, would Peter be the new and antithesis of Lucifer? So I see, you know, like 5 degrees of parallelism between the two. You know, first, both of them were handpicked by Jesus to be the ones, you know, going forward, and both Jesus shared what he was going to do to and for humanity, and both of them took Jesus aside to try to dissuade him, and Jesus reprimanded both, and Lucifer turned and is now the guardian of the gates of hell, and Peter repented and now is the guardian of the gates of heaven.
That's interesting. I've never heard it put that way before. I think there's an interesting parallel there. I don't know if I would go as far as you are, but I do certainly see that there's an interesting parallel. And you know, we as Catholics, there's that old axiom that says, on essentials, unity, on non-essentials, freedom, and in all things, charity. So yeah, that might be something that's worth diving in a little bit more, but I don't want to go any further than that.
All right, John, we'll leave it there. Thank you. You did come up with a new one. You were correct about that. Let's go to Kristen in Abilene, Texas. She's listening on Guadalupe Radio. Kristen, your question for Tim.
Yes, hi. I was calling to see if you could explain the difference between the Catholic doctrine of original sin and the Eastern Orthodox doctrine of ancestral sin. I am Orthodox, and I live somewhere where there's not really a lot of Orthodox people, and I'm considering becoming Catholic, but I want to make sure that I'm not like veering too far away from
right. Well, yeah, as far as I understand it, I don't believe there is any essential difference between the Eastern idea of ancestral sin and our understanding of original sin. It's different ways of communicating. I know the Orthodox that I've talked to, they have a problem with our definition of original sin. But when I talk to them about, it seems that they simply say we over-define things. Whereas the Eastern idea of ancestral sin is much, I think, closer to the Orthodox or the real Orthodox Jewish understanding of how, you know, it's much more of a mystery of, you know, Psalm 51, in sin I was conceived. And so there is that sense of ancestral sin, that is that the sin of Adam is applied to me in some mysterious way. But I don't think, at least in what I have read, you know, it's not as though they go so far as to say, you are responsible for Adam's sin. There's no sort of, you know, contradiction in that sense. So it seems to me that there's nothing essentially different here. Now, I could be wrong there. Somebody could correct me on that. But I don't think there is any problem, Kristen, with any Orthodox person who becomes Catholic. While they certainly would not be able to reject the Catholic notion of original sin and say it's wrong. But I don't think you have to do that in order to accept the Eastern Orthodox position either.
Okay. Because I was just trying to, like, the way I was taught, you know, ancestral sin is something like, you know, it's this sin environment that's all around us. We aren't necessarily born guilty of sin or born in any specific way that says you're going to sin, except you're a human being on earth surrounded by sin. And that is the ancestral sin.
That would be certainly true. That would be certainly true, Kristen, that... Oh, my goodness. Do we have to take a break?
Yeah, we'll take a quick break. Kristen, if you can hang on, we'll take a quick break. We'll be right back to finish this conversation. My original sin is I didn't watch the clock. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back with more Catholic Answers Live.
A generation ago, Christian parents didn't have to worry about how to explain transgenderism to their 9-year-old children or help their teenager deal with mockery at school for believing in traditional marriage. But today, as our culture decays, we have to know how to talk to our children about these issues. In Made This Way, How to Prepare Kids to Face Today's Tough Moral Issues, Layla Miller and Trent Horn give parents the crucial tools and techniques to form children with the understanding they need, appropriate to their age and maturity level, to meet the world's challenges. If we're not teaching our children how to understand tough moral issues, then the world will. Read Made This Way and learn how to give your kids a firm foundation on which to build a life of moral clarity and happiness. Order your copy of Made This Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000 or logging onto the shop at Catholic.com.
With the recent commemoration of the 50th anniversary of the release of Humanae Vitae, there have been fresh attacks on Catholic teaching from outside and, unfortunately, inside the Church. That's why Catholic Answers thought it critical to provide a vigorous affirmation of Pope Paul VI's prophetic wisdom with our newest book, Inseparable, 5 Perspectives on Sex, Life, and Love in Defense of Humanae Vitae. We asked 5 distinguished contributors to reflect on and defend Humanae Vitae from 5 perspectives, each of them compelling, together forming a mosaic of truth. Don't be caught uninformed when the topic comes up among friends, family, and coworkers. Order your copy of Inseparable today by calling 1-888-291-8000 or by visiting the shop at Catholic.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Kristen's on the line from Abilene, Texas, listening on Guadalupe Radio. We're talking about the concept of original sin and the Eastern idea of ancestral sin. Yeah. Tim, you wanted to say something.
Yeah, I did. And I do think that you'll have some differences among Orthodox believers on the nature of ancestral sin. You know, you have St. Gregory Palamas, who teaches much closer to the Catholic sense, because of course he's Eastern, and you know, he would talk about ancestral sin. The Catechism of the Catholic Church even uses the language of ancestral sin, as I recall, in paragraphs 404, 405. But I guess the distinction is this. I think sometimes folks in the East will misrepresent what we say in the West and think that original sin in the West somehow teaches that original sin is a proper sin to each individual, that somehow original sin is transferred to each believer. And that is not true, you know. In fact, the Catechism in those same paragraphs there, and by the way, in the Catechism paragraphs 404 and 405, it's in the Greek translation of the Catechism that you'll find actually the term ancestral sin used for our Eastern Catholics, mm-hmm. right? So, you know, at least from the church's perspective, we see ancestral sin and original sin as being synonymous. At least they can be. But now, again, you have like St. Gregory Palamas and others from the Eastern perspective that would say that original sin does include the tarnishing of the individual, just like we do in the Catholic Church, in as much as the original sin of Adam and Eve caused a loss of sanctifying grace and the original preternatural gifts that include the gift of integrity, where the passions were perfectly ordered in accordance with right reason, that gets out of whack. That's part of ancestral sin for a lot of Orthodox people that you talk to, so that it is not exclusively a sin extrinsic to the person being considered. No, it's purely the sins of the world surrounding the individual. But then again, you do have some in the East who say, well, baptism takes away original sin, and so they don't have that sense of fomes peccati that we do, the fomes peccati, or the tendency to sin that remains. Although, as far as I know, and I'm sure I'll get some calls or emails from some of our Eastern friends here, most Eastern Orthodox do not agree with that. Most Eastern Orthodox, at least the ones I've talked to, acknowledge that original sin does, even though taken away, the stain of original sin is taken away, the tendency to sin still remains within the person and not just as a result of the world and the devil. But there is that sense in Eastern theology that it's the world, the flesh, and the devil. And I would say to you, Kristen, that certainly St. Paul is very, very plain that post-baptism, we still have the flesh to deal with. And that our temptation, while it does come from the world and from the devil, 1 John 2:13 talks about the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life, right? It's the world, the flesh, and the devil, clearly in sacred scripture. And so at any rate, I think a lot of times what you have is among some Eastern Orthodox, at least that I've talked to, that they'll say things like, you know, you Catholics believe you inherit the sin of Adam. And that's not true. We don't inherit the sin of Adam. You can't, and this is why the Catechism says original sin is not a sin, properly speaking. It's a sin by analogy. It's only a sin, properly speaking, to Adam and Eve. We use the term sin by analogy. Why? Because we inherit the damage caused, that loss of sanctifying grace, and then that fomes peccati, the tendency to sin. So there is a little of that too, that, you know, false notion that somehow we inherited the guilt of Adam's personal sin. And that's just not true.
Kristen, thank you very much. Appreciate the call and the questions. And we got to move on now. Ashley in California is up next. Ashley's listening on the Catholic Answers app. Ashley, your question for Tim Staples.
Hi. Thank you for taking my call.
Yes.
I was in Mass on Sunday, and during the middle of Mass, a man entered the sanctuary and was dressed rather odd, like a nun. It was very strange. And he started acting like how you imagine, like how Hollywood depicts a person possessed by a demon. And it got me kind of thinking, after I was done being absolutely terrified, are people who are possessed by demons physically able to go onto fully consecrated ground?
Yeah. Oh, sure. Yes. In fact, Ashley, years ago, I remember the Holy Father was actually in procession at the Vatican when a person manifested demon possession, and he actually stopped and performed an exorcism right there in Rome. and actually was not successful, and later an exorcist would have to deal with this demon because evidently it was a very powerful possession. So, no, demons can in fact manifest even in the... I remember Father Bill Casey years ago. My gosh, this just jumped into my head. I remember being at a conference, and you know, you've seen gargoyles, right? And of course, gargoyles are there to, you know, for water to drain and that sort of thing. But also, there are purposes for them, and you'll find in some monasteries, ancient monasteries, that they would actually have. There's another term too. There's gargoyles, and then there's another word for like these demonic creatures. They would actually put them in the monasteries where the monks were praying, over in the corner and stuff. And it was just a reminder that the devil can come in here too.
Oh,
you know, I remember Father Bill Casey making that point that. You know, we have to remember that the devil can attack you even in the middle of Mass, can try to tempt you to lead your mind away from the Eucharist, tempt you with all sorts of thoughts of past sins and all sorts of things. So we do have to have a healthy respect for the power of the enemy while never, ever giving him too much credit, because we always also remember in 1 John 4:4, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world.
Okay, Ashley?
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you for that great question. Vampires, though. No, I'm not going to go there.
Here we go.
No, I'm not going to ask you a vampire question or a zombie question, because demons are real. I don't believe in vampires. But no. Demons, those...
They are real.
They are real. And, yeah, best to just stay away from them. Marie... assistant producer Marie has come into the studio. What is up, assistant producer Marie?
Not too much. Just having some licorice in the studio today.
And you came in to share that with
us. Yeah. Well, and I also came in to talk about Radio
more.
Club.
Okay. All right, good. I wondered.
Yeah. We'll just leave it at that. No, we are still inviting you to be a part of Radio Club. We had our conference this last weekend, and... the Radio Club letter is going out today, and it has a fabulous letter by one of the producers on staff.
Knock it off, Marie.
Who knows
who
it is. And anyway, Radio Club is the best way to get exclusives and get the highlights from the week and kind of get the lowdown on what's coming up. I really recommend that you sign up for it. So you can go to CatholicAnswersLive.com. Or you can text Radio Club, all one word, to 44222. A couple people emailed me and said they had a problem with that. So make sure that you're putting Radio Club, all one word, to 44222.
If you want to email Marie, you just email radio@catholic.com as well.
Yes,
and she'll
sir.
Get that email, radio@catholic.com. Thank you, assistant producer Marie.
Thank you.
This was your first conference. What'd you think?
I loved it. It was really encouraging. I had a great time.
I'm very happy to hear
it. Yeah.
Amen.
All right, we'll take a break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Tim Staples right after this.
Hang on. We'll be right back with more Catholic Answers Live.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Catholic Answers Live is brought to you in part by CatholicSingles.com, the website for Catholics who want to meet others who share their faith and values for faith, fellowship, and love. You can learn more at CatholicSingles.com. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicSingles.com for their generous support.
Catholic Radio gives us an opportunity to become part of a larger family. It can be so lonely when we are struggling in our faith or just trying to live our faith on our own. But Catholic Radio connects us to that larger community of faith where we're able to get the support, the encouragement, and the grace that we need to not just struggle on, but to really celebrate all the blessings that God brings into our life through our Catholic faith.
Dr. Greg Popcheck thinks Catholic Radio is important. So should you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Tim Staples, our guest, This afternoon, Tim is Director of Apologetics and Evangelization here at Catholic Answers, and we got to get him on the air while we got him because he's heading off to Australia next week. If you're in Australia, he's going to be in Sydney. He's going to be in Melbourne. He's going to be in Perth. He's going to be in someplace else.
Brisbane. Amen.
Check it out. What's the website to find out where you're going to be?
Parousiamedia.com. Parousia, that's Parousiamedia. So parousiamedia.com.
And don't delay with the Parousia. You don't like a
That's
delayed
right.
Parousia.
He's coming.
He is indeed. Joe in Omaha, Nebraska, listening on 102.7 Spirit Catholic Radio. You are up next, Joe. Your question for Tim.
Hi. My question is relating to the validity of ordinations of priests. And so it's my understanding that Eastern Orthodox priests have valid priesthood according
yes.
to the Catholic Church,
correct.
And that's why their Eucharist is also is valid.
Correct.
Right.
Yes.
And the definition of a valid ordination then it's somewhat confusing to me then because.
Right.
Because it wouldn't be no bishop could just simply find a guy in baptism ordinate him as a priest with just no seeking guidance from like the Holy Father, right? Or perhaps like no priest could just ordinate just some random guy, right?
Right.
Even though he is a priest of the valid order, he
right.
can't just go do it.
Correct.
So,
okay, well, let me jump in. That's a great question. No, the Holy Father, as far as validity goes, the validity of an ordination, the Holy Father does not have to be involved at all. What's essential for a valid ordination of a priest is, number one, the valid consecratory prayer of the bishop, and it has to be a proper form. Now, the church doesn't have a specific formula for what is that valid form. It's actually changed over the centuries, but the church does, and ultimately it's the Holy Father who ultimately has the authority to declare this one is valid, this one is not. That's why, for example, when it came to Anglican orders, the Holy Father, Pope Leo XIII, declared that one is not valid, right? And gave his reasons why. So for the validity, or we would say the proper form, just as in with any sacrament, there has to be proper form and proper matter. So the bishops, and by the way, for validity, you only need a bishop to consecrate. A priest can't consecrate. So if a priest were to attempt to ordain another priest, that would be invalid because it must be the bishop's consecratory prayer that asks for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit and his gifts proper to the ministry to which the candidate is being ordained. So it has to be, distinguish between, is this a bishop's ordination, a priest's ordination, or an ordination to the diaconate. So that's the proper form. And you have to have the proper matter, which is the laying on of hands of the bishop, along with that consecratory prayer. Now, some will argue, of course, you have to have, there's the sort of extended matter of a male validly baptized. But the point being here, I think, to get at your question, is if you have a bishop that is not even in union with the Holy Father, say, like with the Orthodox, they were excommunicated, became schismatic. They still had valid bishops who were ordained validly. And so because of that, and this is why it's so serious, it's so grave, when we have schisms in the church where you have valid bishops and they leave the church, It's a very, very grave situation because they have so much grace to whom much is given, much is required. But they have so much grace, they can in fact ordain other bishops and then ordain other priests as well, which tend to cause their schisms to have more power and to be more enduring. I mean, if you look at, for example, the difference between the Orthodox and the Protestants, I mean, it's like night and day. Protestantism, because, you know, relatively speaking, I mean, they have a lot. They have the Bible. They have two sacraments of holy matrimony and baptism. They have, you know, their belief in the Trinity and the divinity of Christ and such. So, I mean, they have a lot, but they don't have all seven sacraments. This is why the Orthodox have been around for 1,000 years and really have remained quite steady. I mean, they have their disagreements and unfortunate things that they teach, you know, with divorce and remarriage and others. But I mean, with Protestantism, I mean, there's very little left that is even bears any resemblance to Christianity of 600 years ago. I mean, there's very, you know, so the point being that the bishop who is a valid bishop has the power to ordain other bishops and other priests. And that's why we say that even though the Holy Father is not, did not give his permission and such, you would have the original bishops, you know, who left the church, who were in union with the Pope. Of course, they sinned, objectively speaking, gravely in leaving the church. Their ordinations were objectively grave matter, right? So that's a very serious sin. And in fact, any bishop today, you look at the various schisms that have happened even since the Orthodox, any bishop who would ordain another bishop without the approval of the Pope because of the state of the law of the church now, they sin gravely, but their ordinations are still valid. Hence the serious nature of, say, the Society of St. Pius X, right? When they performed a schismatic act and declared as much in 1988. Now, there's been a lot of good stuff happen since that time. Hopefully, we're moving back toward reunion with them. But the bottom line is, as long as you have a validly ordained bishop, he can, in fact, ordain another bishop or priest. Does that get at your question?
Yeah, that's a great answer.
All right.
Thank you, Joe.
Thank you.
Should have asked Joe what he thought of the new music. Darn it, I let him go. Because since he yes. liked Tim's answer, he was right in the perfect time to ask if he liked the new music. Oh, well. Anonymous in Bloomington, Indiana, listening on 89.9 FM. You are up next with Tim Staples.
Hi, Tim. Thanks for taking my call.
Yes.
My question is, so I understand why the church has an all-male priesthood, because, you know, the priest is offering the sacrifice in the place of Christ, and Christ was a male. So the priest has to be male. That being said, why is it that permanent deacons have to be all male? Because permanent deacons aren't doing any of that. They're not offering the sacrifice. They're not standing there in persona Christi. They're not hearing confessions in persona Christi. They're just basically old dude altar servers. So why don't we have female ordained altar servers?
Oh, boy. Well, they are certainly not just sort of glorified altar servers. You ask a great question. But one key reason, in fact, we talked about this in the first hour, but I'd like to read to you, I quoted it earlier, but St. Paul says in 1 Timothy 2:12, I permit no woman to teach or to have authority over men. She is to keep silent in the church, for Adam was formed first, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor, yet the woman shall be saved through bearing children, and if she continues in faith and love and holiness with modesty. And then right there, this leads into his discussion of holy orders, both bishops and deacons. It's important that we understand Paul's reason for saying that the woman cannot teach. Now, you know, I noticed in your litany of things that you say that a priest does, you didn't mention the official proclamation of the gospel, but that's an important part of what the priest does. The priest is called, in fact, to deliver the seed, which is the word of God. I think of Mark chapter 6, you know, Jesus had pity on the multitudes because they were like sheep without a shepherd, and he taught them, right? I mean, it gets at the core of what a priest is, what Jesus is, you know, and what holy orders is that official proclamation of the gospel. And so the official proclamation of the gospel is, according to St. Paul here in 1 Timothy chapter 2, this is the first thing he mentions, even before offering the holy sacrifice and such, which distinguishes the male from the female in being that official teacher. And again, I mentioned this earlier, but in 1 Timothy 2, Paul is talking about not just women can't teach at all, because in 1 Corinthians 11, he talks about how women should teach, you know, with a veil on their head and such in submission to the man. Here, he is clearly, you know, this is in the context of a pastoral letter. He's writing to a young bishop that he had ordained. He's about to teach on the holy orders. But I find it significant that the reason he says that the woman cannot teach is rooted in nature, in the order of nature. Adam is first created, then Eve, and in the order of redemption, right? It was not the man that was in the, you know, was deceived, but the woman. What is he talking about there? Of course, it was Eve who was first deceived, and then she used her powerful intercessory powers as the woman to bring death to Adam, and then, of course, bring death to all of her children. As I mentioned earlier, there's a powerful principle in Catholic theology that we refer to, grace builds on nature, and that's Paul's argument here. There's an order to creation and an order to redemption, and it's in that context that it is the man who delivers the seed, which is the word of God. And I argue in an analogous way, just as it is the priest who delivers the seed of the word of God that comes to us in the most profound way in the Eucharist, the word made flesh, he also proclaims the word by preaching the word. Now, the deacon does not do, as you rightfully said, he cannot bring the word to us in the sacrament, but he does bring the official proclamation of the word that St. Paul says is integral to holy orders and its purpose. Does that make sense, Anonymous?
Not really.
Okay, why is that?
The deacon, if he's there at Mass, says it, reads the gospel, but I don't see why you would need to be ordained to read the gospel, or why you would have to be a man to
read
the gospel.
Not to read the gospel, but proclaim the gospel. And again, this isn't you know, Tim Staples here. This is St. Paul. I permit no woman to teach or to have authority over men. And that's in the context, and that's why it says to teach or to have authority over men, she is to keep silent. You know, I don't know how St. Paul can be any more plain than to say that, right? I mean, what is he saying there?
Well, I mean, I guess I'm just further confused because, I mean, as you pointed out even earlier, it's not that, you know, women are still allowed to teach. I mean, heck, most of our Catholic school teachers are women.
Absolutely. But not in the context of the official proclamation of the gospel. And that's the context of 1 Timothy chapter 2. If it means anything at all, St. Paul is talking about the official proclamation of the gospel in the context. What does he do? In the very next breath, he says, this saying is sure. If anyone aspires to the offer of bishop, he desires a noble task. Now a bishop must. And he goes on to give, you know, the qualifications for bishops and deacons. That's the context. I think sometimes we can get confused by the division of chapters and verses, because in the original Greek, there's no chapter and verse. His proclamation here of the official proclamation of the gospel leads right into his description of the ordination of bishops and deacons. And that's why there's a very strong argument to be made here that St. Paul is saying no to the woman making that official proclamation of the gospel, which a deacon does at Mass.
Anonymous, thank you very, very much for that call. We will have to leave it there. And it's not always popular, that gospel of ours. And,
no.
And that's tough stuff to talk about, but it remains the gospel, even nonetheless. Thank you, Tim Staples, for 2 great hours.
Oh, is it over?
Can you believe it?
It can't be over that fast.
You did a fine job, Tim Staples.
Thank you, brother.
We'll see you tomorrow, God willing, on Catholic Answers Live.